வணக்கம். தமிழீழம் ஐ ரேடியோ நேயர்களே, இன்று ஊடகவியலாளர் மற்றும் எழுத்தாளர் உசா இன்டர்வியூ பண்ணியிருக்கிறோம். அவனுடைய அனுபவங்களையும் அண்ட் சி வில் பி டாக்கிங் இன் இங்கிலீஷ் அண்ட் பிகாஸ் இட் ஹேஸ் டு கோ டு த இன்டர்நேஷ்னல் கம்யூனிட்டி, ஸோ வி ஆர் டேக்கிங் திஸ் இன்டர்வியூ இன் இங்கிலீஷ். And welcome Mrs. Usha Sriskandaraja, and we welcome you to the Tamil I Radio. Hello.
Vanakkam, vanakkam, Tamililam I Radio. I would like to thank Tamililam I Radio for this opportunity to set the record straight on Black July. I also want to say that I'm a ardent supporter of Nadakadanda Tamilila Arasangam, and also Viswanathan Rudrakumaran, the Prime Minister of Nadakadanda Tamilila Arasangam. So this year is the 36th anniversary of Black July, and we must never forget and never allow the world to forget Black July. We must continue to agitate for justice for the victims of Black July and all the countless victims, maybe 200,000 victims of the continuing genocide that's being perpetrated against the Tamil people in the island of Sri Lanka. Black July was a pogrom orchestrated against the Tamil people, and as evidence will show by the Sri Lankan government of J.R. Jayawardena, as part of a continuing genocide lasting 10 days, leaving more than 3,000 Tamils killed, 18,000 Tamil homes and numerous businesses burned down, and personal possessions lost and looted, with 150,000 Tamils made homeless, resulting in an unknown number of internally displaced Tamil people that led to a mass exodus of Tamil refugees fleeing the island, now part of a formidable Tamil diaspora. At this time, my thoughts go back to where I was on Black July, what hardened my resolve for a free Tamililam, and more importantly, the need for setting the record straight on who was responsible for Black July. Black July was not a spontaneous response by the J.R. Jayawardena government to the ambush killing of 13 Sri Lankan soldiers, allegedly by the LTTE. A false narrative that Sri Lanka would have the world believe. Black July was a Sri Lankan government-sponsored, premeditated, and targeted campaign of violence that was unleashed on the Tamil people, on their person, on their properties. It was part of a continuing genocide to destroy the Tamil people, their national identity, their language, their right to a homeland in the north and east of the island, their right to be recognized as a nation of people, and their right to self-determination. Their inalienable right to be able to be the architects of their own destiny. Looking back and recalling those fateful days and weeks in July 1983, brings back awful memories of where I was, and pondering on certain defining moments in my life, those that harden my resolve for a free Tamililam, which I can't seem to shake when nothing substantive is being offered in the form of reconciliation and a political solution. We were living in Manila in the Philippines in the late 70s, 80s and 90s. In the month of July 1983, we decided to go back home and also visit London. The first leg of our journey was to Colombo. Once we arrived, rumors were circulating amongst the Tamil community of an impending pogrom against Tamils. We were asked not to travel around too much, and hence our plans to go to Jaffna, Trincomalee, Batiklo, and Kadirkamam were put off indefinitely, very much to our disappointment and dismay. I am from Batiklo, Navatkuda, and also from Alavati and Mallaham. My father was from Alavati and Mallaham, and Sandilipai too. And my mother and my grandfather from my mother's side was from Navatkuda, Batiklo. With much concern for the safety of the Tamil people very much in the forefront of our minds, we proceeded on the second leg of our journey to London to visit my sister-in-law and husband, Mr. A.T. Murthy, who was the High Commissioner for Sri Lanka in the UK. With plans afoot to return home to Colombo and Tamilalam on our way back to Manila. We were so sure of returning that we even left our luggage with relatives in Colombo, but it was not to be. On the 23rd of July, our worst fears came true. Another pogrom. A dire warning was received by the Sri Lankan High Commissioner in London, my brother-in-law, as a firebomb was thrown at the front door of his office. Although swiftly extinguished, it was troubling. It was a warning of things to come. Unable to return to the island to finish the last leg of our journey, we got back to Manila as bitter people, very concerned for the safety and well-being of our people, and more determined than ever to stand up to Sri Lankan state terrorism and educate the outside world. If the 1958 pogrom against Tamils, when I was only 7 years old, crying for my parents who were caught up in Kurunagala while I was in Colombo with my grandmother, had stirred up some emotions in me, if my study of government and the Solbury Constitution had some bearing on me, if events thereafter, even whilst living abroad, most notably the Vattukote resolution, had aroused more feelings of disenchantment in me, beckoning a strong desire for a separate Tamil Eelam, Black July, suffice to say, made me a much more hardened freedom and human rights activist for more than one reason, and there was no turning back from then on. Having heard of the massive displacement of Tamils, most rendered homeless after their possessions were looted and their houses were burned down, with some of their loved ones murdered in cold blood by Sinhalese goons, reminding me of the 3,000-strong mob carrying Molotov cocktails surrounding my husband's family home in Ratmalana to burn it down with him, his mother, two sisters, his brother, and around 90 Tamils who had sought refuge in their home. A mob who had held at bay these people in the 1958 pogrom. I was already making plans, thinking of all this in my mind, even in midair flying back, to utilize the reservoir of goodwill in the international community in the Asian Development Bank in Manila to seek their help to provide relief for my people. Upon my return, my husband and I decided to collect non-perishable items, especially baby milk and also new clothes to send to our people, those in dire need, who were internally displaced and had lost everything. Thankfully, the Philippine Red Cross was willing to air freight the goods free of charge. As soon as we approached them for help, they were so kind. Unfortunately, mainly some Sinhalese professional staff members in the Asian Development Bank, where my husband worked, prevented us from collecting potentially huge amounts of relief goods from the large Asian Development Bank community through the auspices of the ADB Women's Club. They did not like our letter of appeal, which mentioned the word Tamils as displaced and needed help. They wanted the word Tamils replaced by the word Sri Lankan. They went to the committee spreading stories that we were associated with the LTTE. And sadly, some Sinhalese who were leading the objections involved in scaremongering were relatives through marriage of some Tamil cousins of mine. The rejection of the letter of appeal put paid to our plans to send a large consignment of relief goods to our people. Although with the help of some in the Tamil community, we went back and collected as much milk foods and new clothes and sent it anyway. This sour incident impacted our lives in Manila and has stayed with me, widening the ethnic divide and causing the breakup of friendships that I once thought had special meaning. No more joint Tamil-Sinhala parties or coffee mornings, no more New Year celebrations together or attending the Sri Lankan flag-raising ceremony at Independence Day, no more going to Sri Lankan Sinhala cultural events and manning Sri Lanka stalls and pavilions for me. Let's make it loud and clear that Black July must not be referred to as some communal rites. The book, Sri Lanka, Island of Terror and Indictment, one of the many historical accounts written about Black July and of the pain and suffering endured by the Tamil people, explains how previous pogroms, and there were many, and this one, were incorrectly reported in the local and world media as communal rites. A pogrom, according to the North American Encarta Dictionary, is described as a planned campaign of persecution or extermination sanctioned by a government and directed against an ethnic group. And let me tell you, without mincing words, that that is how it should be referred to. It was an organized massacre, and in scale and ferocity and in sheer barbarism, it had that, at that time, exceeded anything that they had previously endured, the Tamil people had previously endured in the hands of the Sinhalese majority. At that time, we, the Ulam Tamil people, could not foresee or ever imagine what would happen in our lifetimes, that the worst was yet to come, that there was on the horizon a much more, far more brutal, hitherto unspeakable, horrendous mass atrocity against the same people, the same Tamil people in the island of Sri Lanka, once known as Ceylon. This time at Mullivaikal, one that happened in 2009, intended actually to finish off on a mass scale the Tamil race in the island of Sri Lanka. The Sinhalese insist the 1983 pogrom against the Tamil people was caused allegedly by an ambush by the LTTE, which killed 13 Sri Lankan soldiers, allegedly. It must be told and recorded for posterity, the LTTE, the Liberation Tigers of Tamil Eelam, a militant liberation movement calling for a separate state, referred to as freedom fighters by Tamils, was born as a natural response to a need to defend the Tamil people against the violence inflicted on them by the Sri Lankan state and its agents, and as a response to government policies and legislation that rendered them second-class citizens in their own homeland. Egged on by a Sinhala Buddhist supremacist ideology, utilizing its majoritarian stranglehold in parliament, successive Sri Lankan governments systematically engineered the establishment of a Sinhala Buddhist state, executing its plans to destroy the Tamil nation in the northeast of the island through legislative enactments, through policies, and two illegal constitutions, 1972 and 78, that replaced the one drafted by the British, which had in section 29/2 an entrenched provision safeguarding Tamil rights that was removed without the agreement of the Tamil people. It must also be remembered the Sri Lankan military were occupying the northeast from 1956, and their numbers were growing as the government started to introduce more and more legislation and policies to curb the Tamil people's right to enjoy equal status with the Sinhalese, with respect to their language, to hold their government jobs, with promotions and increments at par with their Sinhalese counterparts, without having to gain proficiency in Sinhalese and to enter university solely on merit, without discrimination and being subjected to standardization rules, which demanded higher marks from Tamil students with the sole purpose of reversing the high rate of Tamil students entering university. The military was deployed by the Sri Lankan governments to crush peaceful protests, satyagraha, against government oppression, persecution, marginalization, and violence. So contrary to Sinhala propaganda, I refer again to Sri Lanka, the Island of Terror, an indictment, chapter 3, that seeks to document the long build-up of events from March 1983 to Black July that amounted to a display of blatant state terrorism involving attacks including acts of torture against Tamil detainees, Tamil NGOs, the Tamil press, Tamil students, Tamil protesters, Tamil human rights advocates, men, women, and children, setting cities ablaze, burning down the vegetable market, shops, petrol stations, in addition to destroying Tamil buildings, Tamil houses, crops, equipment, documents perpetrated allegedly by Sri Lankan security forces, government officials, and government-employed thugs. Further, the issuance of two very suspect orders, the imposition of press censorship and the promulgation of the Public Security Act that gave security forces powers to bury the dead without post-mortem examination, inquest or judicial inquiry of any kind by President J.R. Jayawardena immediately prior to Black July. These lend support to the view that Black July was premeditated, planned, and executed by the J.R. Jayawardena government. Furthermore, authors Thornton and Nityanandan pointed to the then prevailing volatile situation in the country caused by the government press and the Buddhist priesthood, inciting hatred all over the country. All over the country, anti-Tamil feelings were being whipped up by posters and inflammatory articles in the state-owned Sinhalese newspapers. The ideal of a Sinhala Buddhist state in which the Tamil people had no place was being propagated by a fanatical Buddhist priesthood that had long since renounced the Buddhist ideals of non-violence and brotherly love, and replaced them by a gospel of racial hatred towards the Tamils and a false doctrine of the Sinhalese as a superior and glorious people. Authors Thornton and Nityanandan pointed out. I would like to finish quoting the ominous words of President Jayawardena, made on the 11th of July, 1983. This is prior to the 23rd of July, 1983. Please note that. These words still echo in my ear. I am not worried about the opinion of the Jaffna people now. Now we cannot think of them, not about their lives or their opinion about us. The more you put pressure in the north, the happier the Sinhalese people will be here. Really, if I starve the Tamils out, the Sinhala people will be happy. And these are the words of J.R. Jayawardena. Nothing has changed. The whole Sinhala establishment is still continuing a structural genocide against the Tamil people. The whole world must raise their voice and stand with the victims of the Tamil genocide. Thank you for this opportunity. Tamil Eelam I Radio.
Yeah. Thank you very much for your comments and opinion. Thank you for joining us this time. We will continue to talk to you later on as well. Thank you very much.
And all the best to Tamil Eelam I Radio. I commend you.
Yeah, thank you.
Bye.
Thank you, bye. So, with that note, we finish this broadcast and we will be back soon with other comments.